Welcome to New in the Mail, the series that will touch both your passion for electronics and your bank account at the same time. We have a selection of different items received in this mailbag, and I'm going to start with this GPS module. The model number for this is ZX612, and it's part of the Chinese GPS trackers family. I think it uses a similar protocol to the Relay GPS tracker that I showed in a previous video, and possibly connects to the same Chinese web server for data collection, which of course poses the usual privacy risks. But as I've shown in Vollog 274, using a Raspberry Pi, you can set up your own GPS tracking server. On the back there is a label which I've covered. It's showing the serial number, and I've covered that for privacy reasons because that's the one you use to connect to the server. And this does not come with a battery, but it does support a lithium battery, and there are pads where you can solder one on this PCB. I believe there are multiple pads. There are a couple of on this side and another set on this side. So there's a couple of options where you can solder a battery. There is also this micro USB add-on board, which can be used for charging and USB connection. However, when connecting this to the USB, it cycles the USB enumeration sound continuously. So I'm not really sure what's going on there, but I can see a MediaTek USB serial port appearing in the device manager. So this is certainly based on a MediaTek chip. So the next thing I'm gonna try is to solder a couple of wires to the battery terminals and try to power it from those. I'm not gonna put my SIM card in this tracker, and I don't have any spare SIMs right now to try, but I just want to see if it will enumerate correctly over the USB with an attached battery. So after soldering in the battery and turning on the device, it certainly enumerates correctly as a serial port on Windows, and it does respond to 80 commands over a 19600 baud rate on that serial line. Whether or not that provides full control and you might be able to use that as a modem in a different project, I don't know. Further work would have to be done to establish that. But I've also seen it enumerated as a storage device with 15 kilobytes of space. After fiddling with the onboard switch, you can trigger it to go into that mode. And I guess that's part of the MediaTek processor and its operating system. When ordering any modules that use SIM cards, I would suggest making sure you have the proper SIM card size, or just in case, order yourself a set of these SIM card adapters, because they will come in handy. They are really inexpensive and well worth keeping a couple of these around the workbench for such projects. PCBWay.com is the place to get your professional PCBs with affordable pricing, and if you don't feel like wasting time with the assembly process, why not let them assemble your boards with a complete turnkey solution where they handle everything from sourcing the parts to assembling and testing your boards before shipping. Check out their website linked below. My next item is a compact MP3 player module, and if you've seen the previous mailbag video, I've showed the DF Player Mini module in that video, but I thought I'd also try something different to see if there are any advantages to another model. It's the same idea though. You store MP3 or WAV files on the SD card, and you have a UART interface for control, and the output is handled through this 3.5mm jack. Not sure if it's the same chip running the show. Certainly is the same package style with 24 pins, but according to a source on Stack Exchange, this uses the newer YX5300, while the DF player uses the older YX5200. There should be improvements on the power usage, but I couldn't find any solid information online. The control interface should be the same with the same command set, but it remains to be seen. I'll have to compare it with the DF Player Mini and decide which one to use in an upcoming project. Next up, I'll show a few chemical products that I ordered. This is a tube of heatsink plaster. It should be thermally conductive, but at the same time set like glue and provide mechanical strength for attaching heatsinks to ICs. Obviously, it's not going to be the same thermal conductivity as thermal paste, but in some situations, it's preferred for easy installments of heatsinks, and maybe you can accept the lower thermal conductivity. I would suggest storing this in the fridge for it to last longer and applying it in a very thin layer to get the best thermal properties. Also, after opening the tube, it will go dry shortly, no matter how you store it. So this is kind of a one-time use. Next, I have a tube of B7000 adhesive, or maybe just a clone of it because I got it for cheap from AliExpress, and this stuff is not super strong as an adhesive, but it's this transparent type adhesive that works well for gluing small stuff without making a mess, or for those situations where you might want to separate the glued parts later on without destroying them. And if we look closely on the tube, it says stimulate the taste free, so it must be the good stuff, right? Next, I have a tube of silicone grease. It's the white stuff, and they advertise this as kind of universal type grease for 3D printers or scooters, and I'm not sure if this could be called dielectric grease. Maybe you guys can leave a comment below if this would be safe to use in electrical connectors exposed to the environment to protect them from corrosion. I'm certainly not going to use this on the 3D printer. Ever since I got a can of dry PTFE lube, I've been using that stuff. It attracts less dust and there is no gunk residue building up on the parts. Next, I got some low viscosity lubricant for bearings, and I'm not really sure if this is silicone oil or not. Once again, I would appreciate your feedback in the comments below, but the listing said it's good for bearings, and I already have some silicone oil, but I wanted to give this one a try in case it has a lower viscosity. It might be easier for this to make its way inside the tiny bearings and their seals. And those would be the bearings I have on the small brushless motors on my RC planes. And indeed, just by looking at this plastic bottle, it does seem to be lower viscosity. Next, I got one of these rust cleaning solutions. It almost sounds too good to be true. They say you just have to spray this on a rusted surface and it will just dissolve rust and you can wipe it clean. Obviously, this would only work if we are talking about a thin surface oxidation layer, but even so, I have my doubts. So I have bought this nail and construction washer about a week ago, and I've been spraying this with salt and water every day ever since, and they have created this oxidation layer, which is pretty much perfect for testing this kind of chemical. So let's spray this on, and then I'm going to use this brush to see if it makes any difference. Yeah, so I think this works as rust cleaner. Maybe not as miraculous as they make it sound. You do need to put some scrubbing into cleaning that rust. But just look at this washer. It's almost restored. And I'm sure that with a bit more brushing, it would go away almost completely. As for the nail, I did less brushing on the nail, but you can see it's starting to show its base color as well. So this will also get clean if I get to brush it for more. So yeah, this stuff works. I'm not sure how it compares to other similar solutions, but it works. Now back to some electronics. If you've watched the previous mailbag video, you've seen me get the CH341 EEPROM flash tool, but I also ordered this model, the EZP 2019 Plus, which I believe should be faster and it should be supporting more chips. The box is all messed up from shipping. I'm really surprised how well this survived shipping. But inside this kit, we get the programmer, we get this 1.8 volt adapter with a second ZIF socket and a small PCB adapter, as well as the USB wire and a CD, which presumably contains some software. Kind of curious as to the hardware they use inside of this, so I'm gonna take it apart In the meantime, I should mention there are a bunch of accessories available for this. There is, for example, a cable that allows you to connect to LCD panels for reading or writing the onboard EEPROMs. Not sure why you would want to do that, but I find it interesting. It would certainly be funny to find the exact CH341 chip inside this. And it's not using the CH341 chip that we have in the other programmer, it's using the CH552G. Whether that's a good thing or not, I'm not sure, but this is certainly more expensive than the other programmer. And also, as it can be seen from the label on the box, this should in theory support more chips than the CH341 programmer can do. So I'm hoping this is a better and faster programmer. In the previous mailbag, I showed you how I got some silicon earthing wire with the yellow-green specific colors for building earthing straps on metal enclosures. What I was missing in that video are these eye connectors, which you would want to crimp to the ends of the wire for the proper mounting method to a metal panel with a screw and a shake-proof washer. I got three different sizes in here, so depending on the wire gauge, I will go with a different size connector. And I also got these ones, which are the U-style connectors or fork shape. These would not be recommended for earth connections because they could come undone and release from under the screw, but they are useful in lots of other applications that use big screw terminals, like those industrial power supply units. And if you're interested in a universal crimp tool, you should check out Voltlog 223, where I reviewed such a tool that would work with these crimps. My next product is a set of two DC jacks. These have a non-standard size, one of them is 1.1 millimeters, the other one is 1.35 millimeters. And unfortunately, because I've ordered these such a long time ago, I can't remember exactly why I got them. I remember the general idea. I have a device somewhere in here for which I wanted to make a new power cord or modify it somehow, but I can't remember which device was that. It could have been the original camera that my microscope came with. I think I was trying to modify that. I'll have to check. I'm not sure if that's one, but I ordered these many months ago and I have worked on so many projects lately, it's understandable. I will likely stumble on that device again shortly, and this time I'll have these non-standard connectors or DC jacks available for the mod. And my last item in today's video is this bag of threaded inserts. I have a project I'm working on, I have designed and I will 3D print the enclosure, and I would like to insert these M3 threaded inserts to secure the lid to the enclosure using screws. You can find these in different styles, some are better than the others. These are just the bottom of the range cheap ones. They work okay, but if you want the best results, you might want to go for the made in Japan ones, which are optimized for best mounting and strength. Also, for the ones which you get from a reputable manufacturer, you will also get specifications on how the plastic channel should be designed to accommodate the insert. For these cheap ones, you just have to guess and get there by trial and error. These are slightly longer. I also have ones that are just half the length of these. So depending on the application, you'll need to choose a size that works best for you. I'm interested in hearing if you found something interesting. If you ordered any of these items, let me know in the comments below. And if you'd like to see more mailbag videos, just click here for a playlist with all of my mailbag videos. You can support the channel on Patreon with as little as $1 per month to keep these videos coming. Thank you for watching. I appreciate your support, and I'll see you next time with a new video.